Take your Bibles. Let's turn together to the book of the Gospel of John, John chapter 14, John chapter 14. Get your outlines out. We'll be working on them together. As we continue, actually, as we bring to a conclusion the series, this is actually part 9 of the series, ID Me. We started talking about our identity crisis, the identity crisis that's in the world today. It is everywhere. It is rampant, unfortunately. But we have discovered some things about our identity. Our identity shouldn't be, it's not based on who we're connected to. It's not based on our associations. It's not based on how good a person we are. It should be based on a relationship with Jesus Christ. My identity and your identity as followers of Christ should be all wrapped up in our connection to Him and to Him alone. And so we've been looking at several different things. We talked about all the obstacles that keep us from living out our identity. And we discovered that the main one was that obstacle of unforgiveness. When you and I are unwilling to forgive, biblically forgive, we have a real problem. And we discovered what biblical forgiveness looks like. We realized that biblical forgiveness is not a transaction between me and the person that offends me, but it is always a transaction between me and God. Jesus, as He hung on the cross, had the power and the authority to forgive sin, even as He hung there. But He looked at the crowd that was beneath Him and He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what to do," or "they know not what they're doing." Basically, He was having a transaction between Him and the Father. And that's the way that you and I should treat unforgiveness. That's the way we should deal with it, is we should make it an action between me and God, not me and the offended person. Because there's a lot of people you can never forgive. They may be dead and gone. You can never get the response from them that you're looking for. So then we turned a corner as we got further into the study. We turned a corner. We began to realize that in Christ Jesus, everything that was lost in the garden has been restored. We went all the way back to the book of Genesis. We went back and we talked about Adam and Eve, how that when they were first created, how they walked with God and they were completely accepted by the Father. There was no distance. They could call on Him at any moment and they had His undivided attention. We discovered that they were truly accepted. We discovered that they were also secure in that relationship, that there was nothing for them to be fearful of. There was nothing for them to run from, that they had a perfect relationship with their Heavenly Father. And they also had a sense of significance. Those needs still continue to this day, all need to be met. We want to be accepted, we want to be secure, and we want to feel significant. Adam and Eve, they knew significance because God had called them to partner with Him, to be His representatives on the earth. But when they sinned, when sin entered the picture, everything that they had received from the Lord was lost. All of a sudden, acceptance became rejection. They were fearful, and mankind today is still very much afraid of being rejected by others, of being rejected by God, not ever being good enough, not ever measuring up. Their sense of security was gone. All of a sudden, their sense of security, it became fear. What is the Bible said? When they ate, they hid themselves because they were afraid. They knew now that they had sinned against God. And then that sense of significance was lost. It became a sense of shame and a sense of guilt. And mankind continues to struggle with those very issues. We still seek acceptance. We still seek security. We still seek a sense of significance. And what we discovered was that in Jesus Christ, that sense of acceptance, it's been restored because Jesus died on the cross and took the punishment for my sin and your sin. All of a sudden, we are forgiven completely by our Heavenly Father. We come back into that pre-fallen relationship with Him, and we never have to fear our God who reigns on high. That sense of acceptance has been restored through the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus. We looked last week and we discovered that sense of security, that our lives, that important part of us, that spirit part of us, the soul part of who I am, that it's hidden in Christ with God, that it is safe and secure. Somebody can take my physical life from me today, but they can never take what is hidden in Christ with God. I am completely and totally secure. Well, today we're going to look at the third piece of the puzzle, that thing that the world keeps promising if we do certain things, we'll have a sense of significance. But this morning we want to understand that it was in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus that significance was restored to your life and to my life. This morning I want you to know, if you don't hear anything else that I teach this morning, I want you to hear this. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, you are important to God. Listen, the world and the devil will whisper in your ear and tell you that you're too bad. God could never use you. He'll whisper in your ear and tell you that you're not important to God. He has forgotten about you. And I'm here to proclaim to you that the gospel of Jesus Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, proclaims with a loud voice that you, as a follower of Christ, are important to God. Repeat this after me. I am important to God. Say it one more time. I am important to God. Listen, I don't care what your background is. Don't care what your past may have been. Don't care how dirty you are. Even today, I'm here to proclaim to you that you are important to God. You're significant in Jesus Christ. That in Christ alone, our significance has been restored. In John chapter 14, Jesus is talking to his disciples. He's been teaching them that he's set his mind and his face toward Jerusalem. He knows the crucifixion is coming. His death is just on the horizon. And he tells them that he's about to go away and the world will see him no more. The world will be blinded to his presence. The world won't know and they won't see and recognize his hand. Sounds a lot like the world that we live in today. The world today is still blind to the presence of God. They still don't know when God is at work. They can't recognize his hand. They don't hear his voice. But he speaks to his followers and he says something very, very important. He talks about their significance to the Father. John chapter 14, verse 23. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it so I know we're ready to read. All right, listen to what the Word of God says. John 14, 24 or 23. Then Jesus said to him, Judas asked the same question that we want to ask. How in the world can we see you but the world not see you? How are we going to recognize you but the world not recognize you? And so this is Judas, not Judas Iscariot, the other Judas. Verse 23 says, and Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. We will come to him and make our home with him. You know, I was surfing the internet the other night for images of Christ. You know, when you just go and enter images of Christ sometime and the crazies of the Christians come out. I mean, the Christian crazies, they start surfacing. You know, the guy that's flying in the airplane takes a picture of the cloud formation. All of a sudden, he sees a figure of Jesus, right? Or the pop-up toaster, top pops up this piece of toast, and there it is. It's all burnt in there. It's Jesus. It's got to be him. I saw one where the guy opened the jelly jar, and on the lid of the jelly jar, he looked at it and he goes, oh, it's Jesus, it's Jesus, it's Jesus. You know, we see him everywhere. But I have to tell you, you're important to God. Because Jesus said, the place people are going to see him is in you. He said, when we love him, when we serve him, something's going to happen. That he's going to come and live with us. That he will be in us and live through us. And the place that people will see him is not in a jelly jar. And it's not in the smoke from Mount St. Helens. But it's to be in your life and my life. I am important to God. Repeat it after me. I am important to God. Get your outlines out. Let's work on them together. I know that I'm significant because, number one, he is present with me on this earth. You are not alone. Do you ever feel like you're alone in this? You know, sometimes when I listen to the news, I think the whole rest of the world is not Christian. Nobody else knows God. Nobody else is following God. Nobody else is even trying. It seems like everybody else in the world has completely given up. But I'm here to tell you that you are not alone. You're not alone in this world. Even when you stand all by yourself, you're not alone. Notice what Jesus says to his disciples. Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him, and we will make our home with him. This morning I stand before you, and you see a solo individual, but I got to tell you, I'm not alone. Because as a follower of Christ, there is someone else indwelling me. There is someone else living in me. I am not alone. Here's what Jesus said. If we love him, his word will become important to us. It will become that daily guide that we need. It will become the thing that we strive to live up to. And when we do that, this is what happens. The Father himself and the Son, God and Jesus will come and they will take up residence in our life. He says, we will make our home in him or in her. It's interesting, isn't it? The word that's translated there, home, is used back in chapter 14, verse 2. Oh, you don't have to look. I can quote it for you. This is what Jesus said. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I'm going to prepare a place for you. Here's what you need to connect. In heaven someday, there will be a dwelling place for me. In heaven someday, God has a house for me to live in. There are many dwelling places there. But I have to let you know that there are many dwelling places of God on this earth today. And that dwelling place of God, that home of God, the place that God wants to set up housekeeping and be ever present, is in your life and in my life as His followers. He wants to live in my life. He wants to live in your life. So that no matter what comes my way, I don't face it alone. I am never alone because He lives in me, because He dwells within us, because He is present in our life. Look at the person on your right and the person on your left and tell them, you're never alone. Tell them right now. You see, I know I'm significant because Jesus is present with me on this earth. It's always amazed me. I've never been to the Holy Land. I hear it's a great experience. Every time people want to sell me on it, they go, don't you want to walk where Jesus walks? And my response is, Jesus walks where I walk. No, because that's what he just got through saying. He said, when I love him and I follow him and I honor his word and make his word important in my life, here's what it says. I'm going to come live in him. I'm going to come and live in him. So here's what I need to know. Does he walk everywhere you walk? Because he wants to walk with you on the job site, Rick. He wants to walk with you in the gym when you're molding those young men into wrestlers. He wants to walk with you. He wants to live in us. He wants us to realize no matter what happens, we are never alone as his followers. Second thing, I know I'm significant not only because he's present with me on the earth, number two, but I am present with him in heaven. This is one of the great mysteries of the gospel. This is one of those things that's really hard for us to wrap our minds around because we have been taught to see heaven as a destination someday. But I have to tell you that if he's living in me, what he desires is that his will be done in heaven, that it be done on the earth as it is in heaven. That somehow we transfer something going on in heaven to this earth. Notice what this passage says. I've given it to you here. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. But God, who is rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you've been saved. And he raised us up together and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He uses two words there. He uses the word saved and the word sit. He has saved us and he has seated us. And the place that he seated us is in heaven. And both of those words are in the perfect form in the Greek language. Now, I don't usually get into the Greek language because, you know, when I'm dead and gone, nobody's going to go, Pastor Terry sure had a great mastery of the Greek. No. You're probably going to be more impressed that I can make sense out of this passage, that I can apply it to life, because that's what's really important. Here's what it means to be in the perfect sense. It means that it's a completed action that has continual and long-term effect. And here's what he says. He says, I have been completely and totally saved already. And that complete and total salvation will continue to be with me the rest of my livelong days all the way into eternity. But that's not all he says. He says, not only have I been saved, and that's been a completed deal, but I've been seated in Christ Jesus. in the heavenly place. That also is a completed deal. I can't explain it. I don't understand how that I can be here in front of you and you can see me in this physical being, but my spirit being is still with God. My soul is in the presence of God in Christ Jesus. I am already seated there. What God wants to do is not get me into heaven someday. I'm already in His presence. What He wants to do is get some of heaven onto this earth. And the only way He can do that is through people like you and people like me who claim to be His followers. We have to let Him live His life through us. He's I just got through saying it. He's in me. He's alive and living in me today on the earth. And I'm alive and living in Him in that heavenly place. I'm already there. It's a done deal. It's not something I can lose out on. It's not the destination that I'm looking for. Eternal life is about knowing Him, not about getting somewhere. Nod your head this way if you understand. I am important to God. Repeat it after me. I am important to God. I'm important to God because He's present with me on the earth and I'm present with Him in heaven. Number three, I'm important because when He's present with me on the earth and I'm present with Him in heaven, He chose me to represent Him. Do you remember what happened to Adam and Eve? One of the things that they had was they had that sense of significance because they had a purpose. They had a purpose for living. They were to join God and to bring all of creation. They were to be His representatives on the earth and to rule and to have dominion. And Scripture says that in Christ Jesus, you and I have been selected to be His representatives. We've been selected to proclaim the good news. Listen to what it says. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 20. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The world's got it wrong, folks. I got to comment on this. The world keeps thinking, if we just elect the right people, if we just change just a little bit, just incrementally, if we just change over a period of time, everything will get better and better and better. And so they see change as evolutionary. And I'm here to proclaim to you that the gospel of Jesus Christ says that change is creation. If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. If anyone is in Christ, she is a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, everything has become new. Then he continues. Listen to what else he says. Now all things are of God, who's reconciled us to Himself. How? Through Jesus Christ. And has given to us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, not imputing their trespasses to them. He's committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Here's what he says. I've chosen you, the people that I dwell in, and the people that dwell in me, I've chosen you to be my ambassadors on the earth. And here's the ambassador's message. God was in Christ reconciling this world to Himself. How did He do that? Well, this is where it gets good. This is the good news. Now listen, I've been to churches and I've walked out black and blue where the preacher beat me up, making me feel like that I was nothing good, that there was nothing good about me, that I was nothing more than a big fat sinner. Anybody else been in that category? Here's the message. The message is that God was in Christ reconciling the world to Himself, not imputing their trespasses. You know what that means? That's a really fancy way of saying this. What God said was, that in Christ Jesus, I'm no longer responsible for my sins. Christ is. Christ was going to take the punishment that I deserved. I was going to be set free from the responsibility of the sin of my life. And the responsibility would be shifted to the person of Jesus Christ. Listen, if that's not the way it is, then you and I are still facing punishment for the sins of our life. But what God did was took my sins and place them on Jesus when He died on the cross. What a great word. That is the word of reconciliation. That is the word that ambassadors are supposed to proclaim. It's not turn or burn, but it is that Christ has taken the punishment for us. He died in our place. He died for me. And He died for you. Oh my goodness. I'm important to God. I'm important enough for him to send his only begotten son to this earth to die on a cross for me. I'm important enough that Jesus bore my sins in his physical body and experienced the full wrath of God that should have been directed to me. He experienced it. He took it. He faced it. He died with it. He suffered what I should have suffered. But God raised him so that I can know forgiveness. I am important to God. Fourth thing. Maybe number five. I don't know. I've lost count. Number four. Got to keep going. Number four. He empowers me to do all that he expects. One of the reasons that I know I'm significant is because he empowers me to do all that he expects of me. If he wants you to be his ambassador, and he does as a follower of Christ, if he wants you to proclaim this ministry of reconciliation, if he wants you to go tell people about the good news, guess what? He will equip you and empower you to do just that. Now, not every one of us are going to do it the same way. He's not expecting anybody else to get up here and preach like this on Sunday morning. I'm not sure anybody else's physical body can handle how I preach, so we won't go there. But what it says is this. Very quickly, let me show you what it says. Not that I speak in regard for need. Paul's writing from prison, not from the palace. And he's writing about contentment here. He says, "Now, not that I speak with regard to need, for I've learned that in whatever state I am to be content. I know how to be abased, that is to live humbly, and I know how to abound, that is to live in prosperity. Everywhere and in all things I've learned both to be full and to be hungry, to both abound and to suffer need." And then he says this, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Now we've got to be really careful, because I think almost all of us in this room have probably heard that verse and we've probably quoted that verse before. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Unfortunately, many times we kind of cut it off. We don't get the whole verse. We say, "I can do all things." It's like when we become a follower of Jesus Christ, we feel like we step over into this superhero mode where we can do everything. We can do it in our own power, in our own strength, in our own ability. And I'm here to tell you, that's not what it says. It says that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Listen, I can heal my marriage. I can heal my marriage through Christ who strengthens me. I can't heal my marriage on my own. I can break an addiction through Christ who strengthens me. I can't break an addiction on my own. Do you guys understand what we're talking about here? What God calls us to be, what God calls us to do, He also empowers us to be and to do those things. If God's calling me to be a better husband, through Christ I can become a better husband. I can't become a better husband through Dr. Phil. I can only become a better husband through Christ Jesus. I can't pastor this church in my own power. I can't pastor this church in the power of Billy Graham. I can only pastor this church in the power of Jesus Christ who strengthens me. See, I am important to God because He called me to be His representative on this earth. And when He calls us to be His representative on this earth, then He also empowers us to be His representative on the earth. He empowers us to do what He wants us to do. Two more. I know I'm significant, number five, because He invites me to ask for help. Folks, I don't know about you. I'm always on my knees before the Lord saying, "Lord, help me. You got to help me with this." Listen to what it says. This is really good in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4, 14 through 16. "Seeing then that we have a great high priest." Now notice, that's not a high priest and it's not a priest. It's a great high priest. "We have a great high priest who passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Let's hold fast our confession. For we don't have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weakness, but was at all points tempted as we are, yet was without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Here's what Paul says. He says, we've got a high priest, a great high priest who is the person of Jesus Christ, who's been tempted at every place. You've been tempted and I've been tempted, but sinned not. And he says, we can come boldly into God's presence. He invites us to come boldly into God's presence to seek grace when we have a need. Anybody ever have a need? Anybody ever need spiritual strength? Anybody need wisdom? We can come boldly into His presence when we have those needs. You got to understand, this is revolutionary. Paul was writing to Hebrews. He was writing to a Jewish community. And you know what their understanding would have been? Their understanding would have been the temple in Jerusalem. And they would understand what the priest's role was and what the people's role was. But all of us have been invited in to boldly come before the throne of grace. But here's what they would have envisioned. Okay, let's all go to the temple. All the Gentiles, let's go, all of us line up and we go into the Gentile court. And we go in so far and then we see a sign that says, stop! If you're a Gentile, don't go any further. Then all the good Jewish women, you guys can go forward, but the Gentiles, you got to stop right here. Don't go any further. So the Jewish women, they go in, and they get to a certain point, and they see another sign that says, stop! Jewish women, you can't go any further. Jewish men, you can go further. You can go to the court of the Jewish men. And so the court of Israel, they start walking in, and they go in beyond the stop sign. The men, just the good Jewish men. Guess what? That lets all of us out. We're still back in the court of Gentiles. So we go in, and we go so far, and then there's a sign that says, stop! Nobody goes beyond this point but the priest. So guess what? Now it's just me and Jim. We're the only two that get in. We're the only two. We get to go in. We go in a little bit further. We've gone through the court of the Gentiles, the court of women, the court of the Jews. Now we're into the sacrificial area. We're into the holy place, and we're both there together. But then there's another sign. The sign says, halt, don't anybody go except the high priest. Jim, I'm sorry, you're out. I'm left. High priest. I go in, but only one time a year. And it's risky. They got to tie a rope on me with bells in case I'm overwhelmed by the presence of God. But I get to go in. Here's what Paul writes in Hebrews. He says, the stop signs have been removed. We can boldly come before the Lord. It does not matter. That's why the Gospels tell us that there is, in Christ, there is no male or female. There is no restriction as to how far you can go. We can boldly come before the throne of grace and seek mercy and grace and help in our time of need. I am important to God. He's taken the restrictions off. In Christ Jesus, I can go from here to there to His very presence. Listen to me. You don't need a priest on this earth. You have a great high priest in God's presence who intercedes on your behalf and who invites you, come on in, get close, come see me when you've got a need. Whew. Hey, I'm preaching a lot better than you're responding because this is good stuff. One more. This is my favorite. I know I'm significant because He loves me unconditionally. He loves us unconditionally. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent His only begotten Son into the world that we might live through Him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as He, Jesus, is, so are we in this world. There's no fear in love. Perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. Here it is. We love Him because He first loved us. We love Him unconditionally. We love Him because He loved us. His love for us is never ending. His love for us continues forever. Yesterday, Betsy and I went to Ashley's house and we took care of Kennedy, our little 2-year-old granddaughter. We took care of her. Kennedy has one of these fabric dolls. These little babies, you know, that she just loves. I mean, she just loves it. Now, she's only 2 years old, but in 2 years, that baby doll, oh, man, how do I put this diplomatically? That baby doll is dirty and stained and stinky. And you know what? She has baby dolls that are more valuable. She has other toys that are worth a lot more, but you see, unconditional love doesn't seek something of value to love. No, the object of unconditional love is valued because it's loved, not because it has any intrinsic value. So this little girl, this little two-year-old, she comes up and goes, "Pops," and she holds out that baby doll. And you know what? Because I love her, I take that baby doll and I hug it and pat it on the back. Yeah, you know, some of you are grandparents. And she says, "Kiss the baby." So you know what I do? I kiss the baby. And then I hand the doll. She wants the doll back, and then she comes and gets it in my arms. And then I kiss her. See, when you love her, you love the dirty doll. Betsy got on the floor, put her down for a nap, got on the floor. She had 12 toys in her bed with her. And she's laying on the floor trying to get her to go to sleep. And all of a sudden, the first toy comes out of the bed. And she goes through 11. But guess which one she kept? The dirty doll. Because she loves that dirty doll. Listen, I don't care how dirty you are. Jesus Christ loved you so much that while you were yet a sinner, He died for you. When you were nothing more than a dirty doll, He died on the cross. And the Father loves you because He loves the Son. See, I'm important to God. Oh, you may not see any value or worth in me. My value and worth comes from the fact that my Father loves me. My worth and my value comes from the fact that Jesus died for me. I am important to God. So here's the question. How do I get in on that love? Well, three things have to happen. First, you got to admit that you're nothing more than a dirty doll. You got to admit that you're a sinner. Scripture's clear. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all nothing more than dirty dolls. We've gone against God's word, against God's way, and against God's will. We are stinky, dirty, messy, stained. We're messed up. But here's the good news. While we were yet sinners, He loved us and sent His Son to die for us. I've got to admit that I'm a sinner. Secondly, I got to believe that He loved me enough to die for me. I have to believe that Jesus loved me so much that He was willing to go to the cross, that He took the punishment I deserved, that He took the full wrath of God for my sins was poured out upon Him, that He died on a cross for me. I've got to believe that it was personal. Oh, it's one thing to believe that He died for the sins of the whole world. Something else to believe it was for me personally. It was for me He died. And then lastly, I have to make a commitment. I have to commit my life to follow Him. I've got to commit my life to love Him and to see the importance of His Word so that He can take up residence in my heart, in my life. This morning, I want you to know, I don't care who you are. I don't care what your background is. I don't care how dirty you may look on the outside. God loves you. And He sent His Son, Jesus. God loves you. And you are important to God. Repeat this after me. I am important to God. Do you believe that? I am important to God. Let's bow.